And that leads us to the third and final question of this review of the current world we live in. What should change in education and in libraries, our custodians of knowledge and publications? Reinventing education. Not just improving here or there. We need to really reinvent education in terms of content and method, participants, organizational setting, and links to society. In terms of content, of course, there's been a lot of emphasis on STEM education, science, technology, engineering, and math. But we need STEAM, add an A for arts to the mix. Yes, and do not forget the liberal arts and the civics. And we who deal with libraries and with teaching kids need to teach kids better information literacy. In method, we have relied far too long on only instruction. Instruction will remain, but there is certainly distance learning, which is a new reality, guided learning, and we must also give space for kids helping each other to learn. And there shall be, in the future, a lot of self-learning. Now, already we have seen flipped instruction in classrooms where teachers used to use the time for lectures, chalk and talk, and then give students homework exercises. Now we should really use the videos for the lectures so that students who want to see one part more than once can, and use the time, the contact time between teacher and students for problem solving and mentoring. As to the participants, they will be the same. Parents, teachers, students, peer groups, community, media, especially the internet, but definitely peer groups will become real and virtual, and communities will become both real and virtual. And beyond parents and teachers, there are peers. Peer groups are very important. As for the organizational setting, schools and universities are needed for socialization, not only for imparting knowledge. And these institutions of learning will have special links to society. We must be ready to retrain people in a lifelong quest to modernize our economies as science develops new technologies and transforms our productive processes in a way that takes us more towards sustainable development. It should be a lifelong re-education for graduates, for the speed of development means that the knowledge learned at university will become obsolete very, very quickly, and graduates will have to get continuing re-education, and the relationship of the university to society will therefore intensify. Finally, the high school and the university will mediate five great transitions in the lives of youth. They are transitioned from dependent child to independent citizen. And these five great transitions, decisions on continuing study, entering the labor force, a healthy lifestyle choice from safe sex to drugs to other behaviors, and to move towards forming households to become active citizens. Our libraries must move to embrace the future. Libraries have been in the past custodians of the past and must now become incubators of the future. Now, I have to admit upfront that along with Jorge Luis Borges, I've always imagined that paradise will be a kind of library. And historical libraries still retain a very special charm for me. And I am a child of the 20th century library system, like the great reading rooms that we know so well. And I appreciate the collections that libraries have, such as the Thomas Jefferson Library collection at the Library of Congress, or the Ebers Papyrus that is in the Leipzig Library. But libraries were where we would find knowledge in the past, but they have to cope with the reality of everything migrating to the internet, and everything will move from printed codex to a digital book. This is a picture that I'm very disturbed by. October 2010, the first bookless library in the engineering school of the University of Texas in San Antonio. 425,000 books online, 18,000 journals. And this is what the Google tape library looks with a robotic server. And when books go away, what will libraries look like? Well, they will be given computers to work with. But the beauty of that, everything, anywhere, is instantaneously available. That's a librarian's dream. All knowledge is available in even the most remote village schools. So libraries must change with this world. When everything is digital and online, what will libraries be like? What will librarians do? Well, focus areas for librarians include everything from digital scholarship to research data management to digitization to research enablement, teaching, learning enablement, collections, spaces, self-service. So conventional library reading spaces need to be more welcoming, more exciting. Is this a library? No, it's an Apple store. Can you imagine that? Look at this beauty. This is an Apple store in New York. Apple, which in fact pioneered so much of the telecommunications of the world, has gone in the other direction with bricks and mortar to create these spaces because they recognize that ultimately the users of their products want to interact with humans, those people wearing the blue shirts that you see here. They want to interact with humans in order to use their equipment better. So we need welcoming and exciting spaces for libraries, less formal, more user-friendly spaces. And as more books are digitized and moved off-site, we will have the spaces to reconfigure the library and the library spaces. And we need four of such spaces: creative, messy spaces, group study places, researchers who need quite private cubicles, and also a space for community functions. So these are creative, messy spaces, one of which was in the Library of Alexandria. This is a space for group work by students and our traditional customer in the libraries, private, quiet research spaces. And community spaces will keep the libraries active, interacting with the community, making the kinds of presentations that they alone can curate. But change is happening with incredible speed, and nobody can predict where the future will go. So keep changing the plans as the world changes. And even if you choose to be a niche or boutique institution, you will have to change the way in which you present your services. And every library will be part of a global system. And so, having looked at how the present builds on the past and incubates the future, what can we say about where we are going into the future? Do we have any glimpses of this new and alien world that we call the future? Welcome to the future. As William Gibson, who incidentally is a Canadian science fiction writer, who introduced, the future is here, it's just not widely distributed yet. The new technologies are rapidly creating new sciences and new opportunities and raising many new challenges. We talked about the converging new sciences of bio-info-nanotechnologies. We talked about transformative research. And one of the exciting areas of this convergence is the interface between humans and machines, the brain-machine interface, which, with better understanding of the human brain and better mastery of the ICT revolution and direct communication between brain, neuronal activity, and machines is becoming more and more possible. So artificial intelligence and machine learning in modern medicine is interfering in many constructive ways, but we can see much beyond that. The AI revolution is going to come of age, but that is a subject for a separate discussion. So with all these new breakthroughs and paradigms, this intensified interaction between science, technology, and society help us cope better with challenges such as environment, sustainability, poverty, inequality, peace. For that, we will need knowledge of the natural sciences, the insights of the social sciences, and the wisdom of the humanities. That is the mission of the International Science Council, and I'm proud to be a patron of the ISC. And so, my friends, we can do things differently than we have done them in the past. We must embrace the new, we'll overcome the challenges, we'll create our own future. It is the dawn of a new age. Let us embrace it. Thank you.